Hey, how's it going? Last week we did Rawhorn, and while there was a ton of red flags, it turned out to not be completely awful, and it was definitely better than Growlithe. This week's Pokemon is Psyduck, and it's gonna be more like Psyduck. You get it? You get it? I used the homonym Psy that means disappointment to replace the PSY spelling. Are we on the same page here? Guys? Now, I must admit that this has always been a weird Pokemon to me. The anime often shows it as having some sort of psychic powers, and it even learns psychic moves, but it's not a psychic type, despite basically having the suffix for psychic in its name. On top of that, its evolution is named Golduck, despite Psyduck being the one that's actually gold. And I highly suspect that sometime in development, the names maybe got swapped or mistranslated, and that the psychic typing was maybe dropped for whatever reason. It's a mystery, it's interesting. Now, with that said, Psyduck is not going to be threatening the top of the tier list, if that's what you were hoping for. If you take a look at its stats, it's the dictionary definition of what average is, and if you take a look at its level up moveset, it's potentially worse than Rhyhorn's, which says a lot. You don't learn a second move until level 28, and you are stuck with the measly Scratch, which is going to be absolute hell for the first part of the game. Now, if I had to say a few positives for our ducky dude, it would be that water typing is a solid type, probably the second best typing in Generation 1, and that its TM learn set isn't completely awful, it has some things that you can work with. If you are interested in the rules of the run, I do paste them down in the description so that I don't have to say them every time I make a video now, so look down below if you are interested in that. But before we begin, I'd like to quickly say that if you enjoy this content, feel free to subscribe, hit that bell, you'll be notified of my future videos. The most important thing to keep small channels afloat are likes, dislikes, and comments of any kind. So if you are a viewer that normally just doesn't comment, just scroll down and type Ducky Dude, and you'll bless the YouTube algorithm to help get my channel out of the pits of hell. It's much appreciated. Now with that out of the way, let's see how much luck this duck has. As per usual with my runs, I do reset for decent DVs, and I'm going to keep it real with you right from the front. Psyduck is a pretty solid Pokemon outside of one huge drawback, and that's the fact that I'm going to have to beat Brock with Scratch. It's a 40 base power, resisted normal move, and that's all I got. We've done several Pokemon that have a tough time on Brock, but strap yourself in, because this is going to be one of the worst. And the awfulness doesn't end there. Actually, it's just started. Let's take a look at the most simple of battles, the very first bug catcher that you come to in Viridian. That's right, Psyduck struggles on this fight. I lose two times because I get poisoned, and I take so much chip damage over that time that by the time Caterpie comes in, I just can't take it anymore. And this is truly what Rock Bottom feels like, and playing this has already made my heart sad. So I have to grind up before I even do my first Pokemon battle outside of the tutorial rival battle. This is what it's already come to, and this video has already just started. This is where we're at, guys. Grinding Metapods and Caterpies just so I can beat the first goddamn level 6 Weedle that's easily beating me. Eventually, I'm able to level up on 6 on the Metapods. I avoid some poison and regain a little bit of my sanity. With the bug catcher threat eliminated, the rest of the trainers aren't too bad and I start to gain some levels. I get to level 9 and I'm thinking, hey, maybe Psyduck can just magically beat Brock. Let's see how it goes. And I want you to take a close look at Geodude's health here. Please get your face close to however you're watching this video and pay close attention to how pathetic the scratch damage is. Saying that I'm not even close is an understatement, and this is not looking good for old Psyduck. As it stands now, this is going to be a Herculean task to get past this hump. At this point, we really only have a few questions. The first is just how many levels is it going to take to make it to where we can get Scratch to do enough damage to get past Brock? Remember runs like Growlithe and Rhydon took about level 16 and 14 respectively, but their bad normal moves were about 50% stronger than Scratch was, and they also had a little more bulk than our little ducky dude. The second question I have is just how much in-game time is this process going to take? Initially, I was a little worried that I would potentially have to get into my 20s and possibly even maybe level 28 to get Tail Whip to avoid the bite damage, and if that's the case, we might be looking at the first ever 3-hour Brock time. We've had full Pokemon beat the entire game faster than that, just think about that. So to spare you all the time it took me to play through this, I've been playing footage of stuff like failing on the Junior Trainer, fighting the optional rival battle, doing some grinding, and eventually overcoming the Junior Trainer fight. I try Brock, I weave it in there from time to time to see where I'm at. But let's get to it. So without drawing this too much and without being overly dramatic and having a 50-minute Psyduck video, what was the magic level to get past Brock? Well, friends, Psyduck had to get all the way to a rock level, record level of 20. It's not as bad as it could have been, but it's definitely very time consuming. Now let's take a look at the Brock fight. And this fight doesn't go good at all. You need luck here. Scratch is still bad, and if you take over half your health on Geodude, which is very likely, then the Onix is almost assuredly going to beat you. This happens roughly 10 or so attempts. I'll play most of them in the background so you'll just get an idea. Not having a way to bypass the impending bite damage hurts a lot, and it's pretty frustrating that even level 20 isn't consistent, but I did feel like it was doable given enough attempts. So that leads us to the one successful try. I picked up some god tier luck, and the Geodude just went for straight defensive curls, more than I've ever seen in my entire life. So much that I only took a few tackles and I was only missing 12 of my 60 health going into Onix. And you may think that it was smooth sailing from there and it was just an easy win, but you'd be wrong. I'm hanging on by a thread. I go down to a mere 3 hit points and I get another stroke of luck when the Onix goes for a screech rather than any damaging move at all, and Scratch's pathetic damage is thankfully enough to knock it out before I pulled all of my hair out. And I'm sure you're just dying to know, what's the post-Brock time after we've leveled this much? Well, it's 2 hours and 20 minutes. That's not great, but I don't have to tell you that. If Psyduck wants to be better than some of the bottom of the list Pokemon, maybe better than some of the bottom feeders like Growlithe or Eevee, we got some work to do. Hopefully this is as bad as it gets, so let's see what happens from here. To salvage this run, since we've leveled up so much, I'll be doing minimum battles for the foreseeable future. Mount Moon is quick, and the only thing of note is that I get access to Water Gun. It's not a great move, but we are dealing with Scratch here, so it's a very welcome addition. I'll also pick up Mega Punch along the way to further supplement our lacking move pool. And this brings us to rival number 2. The fight starts off a little rocky. I get hit with a crit and I get chipped down to around half health. I do avoid any sand attacks, so that's a positive. And after that, Psyduck just avoids all the damage, and the fancy new moves that we picked up in Mount Moon do get us past this fight on the first try, and that's very welcome after that very awful start. I continue with minimum battles all the way to Bills, and then it's time for Misty. I'd like to say that my health going into this fight being so low was because that I knew that it would just be so easy, but the truth is, guys, I just forgot, and that just goes to show how easy of a time I had with this fight. Misty's good AI will not allow her Pokemon to do her way more powerful water moves against me, and all I'm up against is things like Tackle. Mega Punch can outpace, and I win this one very easy once again, and I get access to Bubble Beam. After that, I pick up Dig, which Psyduck can actually learn, and I make my way towards the SSN. Once I'm there, I pick up Body Slam, and before getting the optional rare candy, I do hit level 28, and we get our first level up move. Wow, we got Tail Whip, guys. We got this now. And this brings us to rival number 3. And now that we have access to Dig, Body Slam, Bubble Beam, we're looking pretty formidable. While Psyduck isn't a powerhouse, so you won't see me one-shotting everything in sight, I do have an easy time getting this done, mainly due to that huge Brock grind and the level difference that it gave us. Afterwards, I pick up Cut, and now it's time for Lieutenant Surge, which, now that I'm thinking about it, has never really been a challenge in any of the water type runs. You'd think that it would be, but in this particular run, levels combined with Dig means that he's actually at a disadvantage as much as I am, if not more. With all that said, I actually do get blasted with a Thunderbolt, and that ends Psyduck's short-lived no-death streak, but the next time, I do get it done. The main reason being that Raichu goes for Thundershock rather than Thunderbolt. I have the tools to make the Rock Tunnel segment not worth mentioning, so let's pick up back in Celadon. But before I do anything else, I set off to the Rocket Hideout, still doing minimum battles to save time, and that means it's time for Giovanni number 1. And if you've learned anything about rock and ground types from the Rhyhorn video, you know that even a meager bubble can ass blast them, so it goes without saying that Onix and Rhyhorn do not like Bubble Beam. Kangaskhan has bad moves and isn't an issue. Overall, it's a short and sweet speed bump on our path to correct this run's awful start. With the Silphscope in hand, now it's time to relax a little bit, get us a nice Sody Pop and the Pokemart. The fresh water to the little girl gives us access to Ice Beam for some much needed grass and eventually dragon coverage. The next errand that I need to run is to get Fly, and we use it immediately to go back to Pokemon Tower to face off with rival number 4. Maybe this time rival number 4 is finally going to be a challenge, right? No, he's not. The only takeaway from this fight is that I don't have a great answer for Gyarados. It's not necessarily hard to get past, but looking ahead, I'll have to fight 2 more Gyarados in the final 2 fights, so that's something to keep in the back of my mind. This fight is overall easy like it usually is. I finish up the tower, I get the Pokeflute, and I head down to Fuchsia before I face Koga. I do go ahead and pick up the last 2 HM since Psyduck's final moveset will actually utilize Surf. It must be said that Fuchsia Gym's psychic trainers are actually not a joke. I did have a good amount of trouble and do have to reset a couple of times to get past them. Poison status combined with my average stats just meant that all the drowsies and hypnos were able to just chip me down slowly. It wasn't a huge hangup, and it really only cost me a few resets like I said, but it's just worth noting for a completionist standpoint. And that brings us to Koga, and I'll be the first to admit that I don't think I played this fight optimally. I went into the fight poisoned for some reason, and I opted to go with confusion rather than dig because I felt that wasting a turn underground and taking that extra poison damage wouldn't be worth it. I'm able to make it all the way to the Weezing, and Psyduck is on its last legs. 23 health, I'm poisoned, I'm at the mercy of the AI. I go for a Hail Mary dig, hoping that maybe he will go for self-destruct, and that's exactly what happens. Sometimes it's better to be lucky than good, right? Now it's time for a rarity for me, something I never do. With Surf in our final moveset, and being a water type, there's no reason to not face Blaine right now. I do battle all of the trainers in the gym for the easy experience, and after some good old-fashioned
Tombstoner, brother,
it's time to get this badge. And this fight isn't too bad. And you might have guessed that, but I do actually lose the first attempt. A rapid ash stomp chips me down to about half health, and then a takedown from Arcanine finishes me off. The next attempt goes much better. I avoid damage almost entirely this time around, and Surfs mixed with a dig gets me past this one fairly easy. And since Psyduck is a water type, I skipped Erica earlier, and now it's time to take care of some unfinished badge business. I actually outspeed the victory bell, but Ice Beam just isn't enough to knock it out. But the Poke Gods smile upon me, and I get a retroactive super potion to allow me to take it out on the very next turn. And like all the Erica battles, once the absurdly powerful Victory Bell falls, it's a done deal after that. Vileplume does survive an Ice Beam as well, but Mega Drain is just a pathetically weak move, and we wrap this one up. Now there's only one place left to go, and that's Silphco. And that's really gonna test Psyduck's power level. I don't battle every single trainer in the building, but I do about 3 or 4 extra to finish off a level, and that leads us to rival number 5, and let's see how it goes. Psyduck is a slow and steady Pokemon. It's not a powerhouse, and we see that on Pidgeot. One Ice Beam doesn't knock it out, but the following turn, we get past it. Gyarados is next, and we really don't have a great answer like we said earlier. Surf is our strongest move, it's resisted, it's immune to dig, Confusion is a weaker move, and we don't have Stab on it. This means that Ice Beam is our only answer, but it takes several turns to get past it. It doesn't have a great offense to deal with us either, so eventually enough beams take it out, it's not too bad. Growlithe is next, it's a pushover, it's weak to Surf, nothing to see here. Alakazam, as always, has the potential to be a thorn in my side, but a first turn disable allows me to set up a dig, which does knock it out in one hit. And last up is the true problem. Venusaur, from here on out, will be a razor leaf roulette. I do outspeed it, go underground for a dig, it goes for a razor leaf, but good luck hitting the duck when I'm underground, bitch. From there, I switch it up to the super effective Confusion to kind of gauge its power level for future battles, and it goes for Leech Seed, then a Vine Whip. I take this fight on the first attempt, and that's pretty surprising, and honestly some good news going forward. That takes us straight to Giovanni number 2. Stab, Surfs, Dig, Ice Beams, they're all super effective against this Pokemon, and I just use a mix of them to get past this fight. Psyduck doesn't really break a sweat on this one, and we're moving on once again. With Team Rocket out of Saffron, Sabrina opens up, and all I have to say is thank God that Psyduck has access to Dig for some physical damage. I utilize it on the Kadabra to make short work of it. 2 hits take out the Mr. Mime, and the Venomoth becomes kind of worrying when it gets off of paralysis on me before I take it out, and the Alakazam here has a really high chance to take me out. But I'm persistent, I'm not getting unlucky with the fully paralyzed procs, and I use Dig over and over and over. It goes for Reflect way too many times, and eventually enough digs are enough to get past this on the first time. The Diggy Duck strikes again. So that's 7 badges down, 1 to go. I head over to Viridian to finish off the regular season. To make sure I'm ready for the endgame, I do battle all the optional trainers inside to just get a little extra experience. The Giovanni number 3 fight is even easier than all the previous ones. He has 4 Pokemon, and all it takes is 4 Stab Surfs to get past this one. I wish I had a more engaging commentary for you, but I do get the chance to learn Hydro Pump at level 52, but no thank you. I get the 8th badge, and that wraps up the regular season. There are 6 battles left, so let's go get it. Before I take on the game's final challenges, I do got lots of monies, and I go to Celadon to spend them on various vitamins to shore up my stats. There was a TM that I wanted here, but I'll kind of talk about that a little bit later. I even pick up Mimic just in case I need it, since the move pool of Psyduck's not really that great. Now let's take a look at rival number 6. The majority of the fight is fairly smooth, and it's looking like another easy fight, but remember last time when I said that Venusaur was just going to be a razor leaf roulette? Well, the AI has decided that it's going to be a razor leaf guarantee. My first attempt, I get obliterated by it. The second attempt is slightly different in the fact that Alakazam just takes me out all by itself. It's good to have things back to normal. Thank you, Alakazam, for being here. The third time, I teach Blizzard over Ice Beam, hoping that maybe I can one-hit the Venusaur, but it doesn't work, and the AI goes for Razor Leaf once again. That's 2 out of 2 times. Very nice randomness game. But what's that? You guys want 3 out of 3? Well, I got you. Here it is, another Razor Leaf. The duck has run out of luck. And finally, on the fourth time, I'm able to get past. You've already seen on the previous attempts that it's not really much of an issue to get past the first Pokemon. The problem is, and will be in the future, is Razor Leaf. You see how different and easy this fight can be when it goes for Vine Whip instead. This is why you choose Venusaur for your rival if you want a challenge if you're weak to grass, because Razor Leaf is so oppressive and strong. I do battle a couple of extra trainers inside of Victory Road, but it's nothing too important. And I'd like to quickly go back to my Celadon visit earlier and bring up the fact that Psyduck cannot learn Reflect. This TM has physical damage, and it can make some of the fights much easier in the Elite Four. It's a very valuable TM for weaker Pokemon. Not having access to it hurt my original plan, so from there I just started looking up how many Pokemon in Generation 1 can learn Reflect. It turns out that about 80 to 85 Pokemon can actually learn it. The ones that can't are Pokemon like Weedle, Caterpie, Magikarp, and of course our dear friend Psyduck. You know, he's a duck. He basically has Psychic in its name, and it learns other Psychic attacks, but it can't learn a very common Psychic move that the majority of other Pokemon can learn. It's just a little interesting to me, and something I thought was a little bit funny. Anyway, this leads us to the door before Lorelei, and we begin our Elite Four journey. Like I always do, I give it the old college try before I make some adjustments. During my first attempt, it's painfully clear that my current moveset is very lacking. I don't have great answers for any of Lorelei's Pokemon. Dig could do an alright job, but a single growl maims my damage and I can't even make it past the Cloyster. The answer to this, like with a Cubone run, is Seismic Toss. I haven't mentioned it yet in the video, but I did store it in my PC just in case I need it, and it's definitely needed on this run. With the move learned, I do give it a second attempt. It does go much better. I make it all the way to the Jinx before I get taken out. The problem now is that we don't really have the bulk or the stats to make it past this fight. Luckily, there's an easy solution, and that's rare candies. I use 4 of them to get to level 60, and I try again. This attempt goes much better, but not great. I take entirely too much chip damage, and although I make it all the way to the Lapras, I'm just in too much of a hole to recover from. I use a few more candies, and I go at it again. The next two attempts end in similar ways. I get a string of bad luck. The first time, Jinx paralyzes me with a body slam, and on the Lapras, going second and hurting myself through confusion just takes me out. The second time, Confuse Ray is a menace, and eventually I get paralyzed and taken out as well. On the third attempt, I'm actually able to make it past. Level 63 is a pretty key level for this fight. It allows Seismic Toss to 3-hit the Dugong and Slowbro. Most importantly, it's the breakpoint to where it 2-hits the Cloyster to avoid extra chances at it using Supersonic or something annoying. You can also 2-hit Jinx with the Surf, and if you avoid a ton of damage going into Lapras, it's not too bad. Like in earlier attempts, Confuse Ray is one of the most annoying moves in the entire game, but with enough persistence, Seismic Toss is able to get us through, despite getting a little low. Now here's some minor spoilers, but I'm not going to show the next two fights just yet, and we're going to skip ahead to show you how Lance goes to keep things sequential. The first attempt, you can really tell how much that I'm missing Reflect here. A Hyper Beam from Gyarados near cripples me, and I make it to Aerodactyl, where a second Hyper Beam then knocks me out and forces me to restart. I keep the experience, and I make it all the way back to Lance without resetting on the next attempt. I survive a Gyarados Hyper Beam way better with the extra 2 levels, but the result ends just the same. A Hyper Beam from Aerodactyl ends the run. I do reset, and I make it back to Lance at the same level as the previous attempt, but this time it goes different. Rather than confusing us and going for Hyper Beam, the Aerodactyl goes for Takedown, and one hit is all that's needed to get past. With Blizzard in our moveset, Dragonite is all but a formality, and I make it to the champion fight for the first time. And here you would think that the obvious choice is that Razor Leaf would just end the run, but in actuality it was the Gyarados. I should have went straight Seismic Toss here, but I didn't, and it cost me this match. and you see how low it got, I could have done it. And at this point, I'm thinking I need more levels to make this more consistent, so I opt not to reset, and instead, I take the blackout so I can keep my levels. And now let's run through the final attempts. I know that I usually keep all of my attempts of the Elite Four members in order, but I'm gonna mix it up a little bit this time. So here's how Lorelei looks at level 69. Nice. It's about the same fight we went over earlier, except our main source of damage and stats are better due to being a lot higher level. It's just overall a much more consistent fight. I will say that the Lapras still has a lot of potential to be annoying since Body Slam has a high chance of paralysis and Confuse Ray is just a bitch. It does a decent amount of damage, and with a little bit of bad luck, I could see how Psyduck could actually still lose this fight. Speaking of fights that I could never see Psyduck losing, let's talk about Bruno. Did you like that segue? Cause I did. And honestly, there's nothing to see here. He has Pokemon Double Weak to Surf, we are very high level, and I just sliced through every single one of his Pokemon. It's Bruno. We expect nothing less on this channel. Next up is Agatha, and I keep this one short as well. There's a reason I skipped it in the initial section of the Elite Four. Access to dig against her poison types tell a story that we've heard countless times in all of my runs. As you gain levels, this fight becomes significantly easier and easier. In this final attempt at level 70, I outspeed all of her Pokemon to guarantee that I can avoid any pesky status moves. The final Gengar does outspeed me, but there's not much chance for it to kill me barring some awful luck. This one is another easy fight. So now this takes us back to Lance, and you've already seen the struggles and the blueprint for victory here. I will say that I did fail Lance two more times and I had to redo the entire Elite Four before the actual successful attempt. It's a little easier with the extra levels, but Hyper Beam is just really strong. I can't stress enough how much Reflect would have trivialized this fight and I wouldn't even have to grind as much as I did. Now let's take a look at the final champion fight. Pidgeot is up first, and Blizzard's all that you need here. Alakazam is second, and a dig doesn't quite do the job. It comes kind of close. It goes for recover, but it doesn't recover enough, and a second dig takes it out, and we're moving on. Rhydon is double weak to surf, so you already know what's going to happen here. And Gyarados ended our runs a lot today, but I've learned my lesson. I go straight seismic toss this time, and I do take a lot of damage from Hyper Beam, but overall, I'm still about half health when it finally goes down. Arcanine is in the same boat as Rhydon. It's weak to surf, and although it's tanky, it can't survive one with our higher stats due to our massive level at this point. And now for the finale. If Venusaur goes for Razor Leaf, it's another reset. I go for Blizzard, it does massive damage, and now's the moment of truth. It charges up for a Solar Beam, and that seals its fate. I go for a Seismic Toss since it's got 100% accuracy, and I finish off the run. Now overall, I don't think Psyduck is the worst Pokemon in the game. It's better than Pokemon like Growlithe, for example, but that's not too hard to beat. Water typing is probably the second best typing in the game behind Psychic, and that helps it out a lot in this run. But how did Psyduck do? Let's take a look. It finishes with a level of 74 and a total time of 6 hours and 39 minutes. This isn't too bad considering that we had an absolute train wreck during the Brock time, and we were essentially just playing catch up to everyone else on the tier list from the very start of the game. The main drawbacks of Psyduck overall is that while it doesn't have bad stats, it doesn't really have any standout stats either. The worst part of the run was its awful starting move pool and the lack of level up moves into an absurdly high level. Its TM move pool isn't awful, but Surf and Ice Beam being your best moves doesn't necessarily give you a ton of coverage. If it had Psychic or Thunderbolt, for example, this Pokemon could actually probably compete for a much higher spot on the list. Now with all that in mind, all that said, I rank Psyduck behind last week's Rhyhorn by hair. They're close enough to be put in the same category, and it's still better than the Growlithe and Eevee tier of Pokemon, and it's miles ahead of Cubone. Overall, it was just about what I initially expected, especially when I first looked at the starting moves for it, only having Scratch for Brock. Coming up, I'm working on a bigger project for next week, and my plans as of now are to have a versus style video where I redo my first two runs. As the tier list grows, I'm increasingly more and more unhappy with Slowpoke and Clefairy's time, and considering how their time is separated by a minute, they have the same level, they have similar move pools, I think it would be a fun video to pit them against each other and get us an updated time for some Pokemon that are definitely much better than I showed when I was but a noob at doing these solo runs. But that's about all I have for you guys today. I hope you enjoyed the video, and if you are still here at this point, kudos to you. I appreciate you, and I'll see you guys in the next video. Bye!